Working in cybersecurity sucks sometimes, and this holiday season was definitely one of them for anyone who ran MongoDB on their network. Because we had a vulnerability that came out on Christmas Eve by a security vendor, and then Christmas Day, someone published POC exploit code. I know that if I still had my job of running vulnerability management at a large bank, I would have gotten pulled in to an incident bridge on Christmas Day. So any of you watching out here that had to run this incident over the holidays, I hear you. I feel you. If you're one of the lucky ones who hadn't heard about this and didn't need to respond to this incident, MongoDB had an exploit that was super, super easy to actually run and hack. They, of course, called it Mongo Bleed because A, everything with a name is taken more seriously, and B, it is very similar to the Heartbleed vuln of old. If you've known me a long time, I used to do the top 10 web hacking techniques presentation every year. I think Heartbleed was like 2014, 2013 that I actually gave, Heartbleed was one of the top 10, and I had to actually really get deep into figure out how this works. But XKCD, of course, does a much better job explaining this than I ever could. The gist is someone is asking a server for something. And when those HTTP requests actually happen, this is kind of a distilled version of what they look like. Server, are you still there? If so, reply potato. And by the way, I'm expecting 6 letters back for potato. Oh, well, Meg wants these 6 letters. Potato. Potato. Server, are you still there? If so, reply bird. By the way, bird is 4 letters. User Meg wants these 4 letters. Bird, let's say bird. Hey, server, are you still there? If so, reply hat. By the way, hat is 500 letters. The server replies, well, Meg wants these 500 letters, hat, and then everything else that's in memory beyond hat thereon. That was Heartbleed. This is MongoBleed. Same thing, same vulnerability. It's actually kind of crazy that this is the fix. Not all extremely critical vulnerabilities involve an extremely complex fix. This one line of code and just deleting this output part and returning the length. Basically, what this is saying is that if you return output.length, this tells the code to return the amount of allocated memory instead of the actual length of the decompressed data. So now return length just says, hey, just return the length of the decompressed data. And if you're worried about these kinds of attacks in your application, you're going to want to hear from today's sponsor real quick. I've spent the majority of my 18-year career focused on application security. I even ran and managed the bug bounty program for a large social media site. And we would run the latest and greatest AppSec scanners out there and still find thousands of false positives. And we would get bug reports from the bug bounty program of cross-site scripting. And I would sit there and I'd be angry that the first I heard of that cross-site scripting bug was through the bug bounty report. That's why I'm excited to share the sponsor of today's video, Contrast Security. They've been around as long as I have in AppSec. They even defined a whole category of AppSec IaaS back in the day. And I was really excited to get a demo of them all these years later and see that they're still building just awesome features. And the thing that makes them different in my eyes is they're not just scanning your website for vulnerabilities. They are an agent living in your application. So if I go here to this SQL injection incident, you see they're calling it an incident because they have evidence of an attack going on. But they're not a WAF. They're not living on the edge. They're in your app. So I can get all sorts of information about the actual attack that's going on. And I can block it, by the way. But if we go into the observation details and look at evidence here, you could see that because they're in the app, they can also find vulnerabilities, not by scanning this app and like throwing a bunch of SQL stuff everywhere and reading error messages. They can see based on legitimate traffic or attack traffic, when these kinds of things are coded in a vulnerable way, they can say, hey, you're putting this variable directly into this SQL statement. So because they're doing traffic analysis, living in the app, doing the whole AST thing, they're going to beat out normal DAST and SAS scanners because they're marrying all of this information together. Thanks, Contrast, for sponsoring the video. Been a longtime fan of yours, been keeping up. And it's awesome to see that a vendor that's been around this long is keeping up with trends in the industry and what AppSec professionals need. I haven't even touched the iceberg of the features that they showed me on their demo. Do yourself a favor. Click the link. Tell them I sent you. Catch a demo. They'll take extra special care of you. Let's get back to the video. So going back to Kevin Beaumont's post, Kevin, thanks for the write-up over the holidays. I appreciate it. But what this means when it's returning memory, when we say memory, we mean actual memory on the server, not like hard disk, not storage. A lot of stuff gets stored in memory while the server is running, including passwords, secrets, user data, whatever the database is like loading up, about to act on, or maybe it just acted on it and hasn't cleared it yet, is sitting in memory and it's sitting in plain text. The application has already done its thing. If it's encrypted at rest, that means it's encrypted on storage. The application has read it from storage. It had to decrypt it. It loaded up in memory to like do something with it. So at that point, it's all in plain text. So when you're saying, hey, return hat, and then it's 500 letters, you're going to get a whole bunch of just random parts of memory, which include things like certificates that would be used. Heartbleed, the big deal was SSL certificates, because the web server would generally have the certificate loaded to make the HTTPS connection happen. That certificate would need to be loaded in memory. So as Kevin said, because of how simple this is to exploit, the bar is removed. Expect high likelihood of mass exploitation. Well, his prediction on December 26th was absolutely correct. We have varying numbers about how many things were actually exposed on the internet. I saw 75,000. I saw Tamir write this Threat Hunter's perspective one where he actually saw sensitive saying like 87,000 or about things exposed. And this is just the stuff that these databases see that they can like fingerprint properly. The likelihood is this is just widely, widely vulnerable systems. MongoDB on the internet vulnerable. By the way, just important to note here, if you were using the hosted MongoDB, I think they call their product Atlas, that was patched automatically. So you didn't have to go patch it. But if you were self-hosting, you had to patch it. And of course, I'm making this video in the first week in January, and we have been seeing active exploitation in the last few days since the vulnerability came out. Wiz's data, Wiz has like a credible view of the world being as widely deployed as they are in cloud environments. And they're saying that 42% of their cloud environments that they are installed in have at least one instance of MongoDB in a vulnerable version. So that's not saying 42% of MongoDB installs are vulnerable. This is 42% of Wiz's observable cloud environments have a vulnerable MongoDB version in that system. Staggering, staggering that close to half of all cloud environments that Wiz looked at had at least one of these vulns. We don't got a lot of data about the public exploitation. They're saying, hey, the publicly available exploits since December 26th, we have some initial reporting about exploitation in the wild, and CISA has added it to the known exploited vuln database, Kev. I was looking at Florian had written some threads over on Twitter about MongoBleed that were worth talking to. Florian, if you don't know, he's the Yara guy. So, really big threat hunter, Yara Sigma. He looks at this stuff all day. And he was talking about how, patching is mandatory, but log-based detection here is very much best effort, not a safety net. He's saying like kind of hard for people to have detected exploitation in this. That's why I put together a few of these. I saw some other people write up some threat hunting like tips on how to actually find if you were exploited by this, because it is so easy to exploit. And it was happening over Christmas. I assume some people got called in on Christmas. Some people didn't. Some people with, maybe less high alert socks that would have called their whole team in. You had some security teams show up after holiday break and realize that they had to deal with this. So I'll include a link to this in the description below so you guys can actually see some of the threat hunting tips. But one of the ones that he was talking about was this like user assertion thing is going to spike. So here you could see like three asserts is kind of their normal. And then all of a sudden it was up to 3,100. But this is definitely prone to false positives. Depends on when's the last time you restarted the server and all this kind of things. He did release the code. They like help you hunt on some of these things. And then my buddy Eric, he's actually here in Austin, wrote this on December 26th for hunting MongoBleed. So he was on top of it as well. So I'll make sure to include both of these write-ups, and they have code involved in them that will help you actually identify if this exploit happened on your network. If you have MongoDB public on the internet, you're just going to want to assume security incident, assume compromise at this point because of the ease of exploitation and how fast the POC came out. Eric actually put out some Velociraptor rules. If you don't have Velociraptor, it's a really good threat hunting tool that's pretty popular right now. And if we go look at what Rapid7 was saying about it, they were the ones who I actually first saw the GitHub tool, the exploitation POC tool that came out. And then they're also publishing their own Velociraptor hunting artifacts. Oh, no, that's the Eric one. That's funny. I didn't even realize it was the same one. But if we go look, let's look at the POC real quick. If we want to look at the code that it takes to actually exploit this. I mean, not that it takes this much code to exploit it. We saw how kind of easy that it would be to actually send this. But this is like a handy POC that, you know, will take all sorts of options and stuff like this. It'll probe to see if the database is actually on live and healthy and all that kind of stuff. But what we're actually looking for is this whole send crafted BSON with inflated document length. BSON is binary JSON. It's like a Mongo thing because, of course, why wouldn't we have another, you know, thing to worry about proprietary like this format? So BSON with inflated document length, this goes back to the whole, you know, we want to tell it the buffer size is actually longer than it is. This is like a parameter that you can pass through when you call this exploit POC. You can give it like the length that you want to receive in memory. And if we go down, we can actually see the tool is extracting the leaked data from the error response, right? It because it's BSON, you can kind of interact with it somewhat like JSON by matching field names like you would a JSON object and start to pull some stuff out based on like whatever's in there. Like I said, all that code wasn't necessary. You can actually just send these kinds of requests to a Mongo server and get the responses with those like malformed length objects. But this code is like making it easy for you, right? With host flags, length flags, are we going to loop? Are we going to time out? All this kind of stuff. So going back to Eric's threat hunting thing, Florian, who was talking about how hard it is to threat hunt, noticed Eric's blogs about this and then actually vibe coded a shell script to help detect this exploitation. So not all vibe coding is bad here, people. All right. So mongobleeddetector.shell pointed at, you know, some log files it's going to analyze, and it's going to think that, hey, based on the data that I collected, there's a high likelihood that this was an exploited log, you know, line. This is a signal of threat here. So everyone, if you're in those 42% of vulnerable environments in the cloud that might be running a vulnerable version of Mongo, here you go. Here's the version numbers. Here's the vulnerable versions and the patched versions that you need to worry about. Like I said, if you're on the hosted Atlas version, the cloud version of MongoDB, you were already patched. But if you're self-hosting, which a ton of people are, according to Wiz, which is not surprising to me, you're going to want to go ahead and check these version numbers. If you were running a vulnerable version when the time you go and check this, you have to be running an incident and seeing what happened while you were vulnerable. Because that POC has been out for about a week now, and you know that people are spraying that around the internet. If you do find any artifacts of exploitation, I want you guys to make sure that you are rotating all of those secrets that were in memory, okay? So if there was passwords, if there were certificates, if there was API keys, you have to invalidate them. This is not like thoughts and prayers. Yeah, they went out the door. Let's like catalog it and whatever. No, you have to make whatever the attackers stole useless as fast as possible, because if they're using mass exploitation scanning techniques and they're not targeting you specifically, there's a good chance that they don't know what they're sitting on yet. You do have some time here. Maybe you have some time here. If any of those secrets were actually leaked, you're going to want to, you know, secondary incident. Hey, our API got leaked. Let's find any activity on that API while we're invalidating it, all that kind of stuff. If you got paged for this one over Christmas, I want you to sound off, because I'm going to like make a note of your name, and you're a VIP on this channel. I think when I was running the vulnerability team at the bank, I think I went like 3 or 4 years in a row where there wasn't a major US holiday that I didn't get on some sort of incident bridge. This one kind of stinks because it wasn't like an attacker, right? This was a security vendor that released a vuln, and then a researcher, I think it was from Elastic, that released the POC. Usually it's like a nation state cybercrime, whatever it is, that doesn't live in the US, knows our holidays, knows that less eyeballs are on the screen. That's when they get spicy. That wasn't it this time. This was just someone found the vuln in the POC. And so security teams had to step up, go fast, because once the POC is out, the clock is ticking. All right, so just goes to show you, super simple mistakes. You saw that one line of code, super easy for the dev to do that on accident. And it resulted in a very, very, very serious vulnerability for a major database technology that's wildly popular. Kind of crazy. This is, you know, people are like, is AI coming to take our jobs anymore? You know, this is like the forever employed security stuff that we're talking about. All right. If you liked it, you know, do all the YouTube things. I really appreciate it. Thanks. See you next time.